Today's session is basically on the capital market. Now, let's understand what do you mean by capital market. Capital market is a market which deals in the long-term loans, basically. It involves the company's fixed assets and working capital. It helps organization to fund the fixed assets, working capital, and the different finances from the short-term and the long-term borrowings of the central, state, and the financial institutes. Now, the capital market basically deals in the ordinary shares, that is equity share, debentures, bonds, corporations, securities, etc. The capital market basically functions through the stock exchange or stock exchange market. A stock exchange market is market which facilitates buying and selling of the shares, stocks, securities, debentures, and etc. Now, it basically helps an organization to deal in the financial houses. Now, it is not only in the market for the old securities and the share, but also for the new issue of the shares. It's not necessarily the company has the old shares or the securities or bond which they can trade, but at the same time the organization can come up with the new equity shares or debentures and let them traded in the market. Basically, it only ensures that the old securities and the new securities are traded and the new securities and the shares are available to the shareholders and the investors. Now, in fact, if we see, the capital market is related to the supply and the demand of the new capital. The stock exchange basically facilitates such transactions is all about. Now, it is very important. For example, let's say an organization wants to offer a new business or want to invest in a new project. So for them to avail the fund from within the organization make them little difficult, but then when such functions or such facilities are available, they can actually go online or they can go to public, ask public to invest in the company in terms of share equity shares or the debentures and avail funds, and they can invest in the organization. Now, there are basically two components of capital market. The first component is primary market and the second component is secondary market. Now, let's understand what you mean by primary market. Primary market is nothing but the new market. A primary market is also known as a new market share or new issue of issue market. Now, in this particular market, the securities are sold for the very first time. That means the company is not yet gone public to the general public or the investors as a whole. That is, the new securities are issued from the company all by themselves for the first time. The primary market basically directly contributes in the capital formation, because in the primary market, the company goes directly to the investors and utilizes their fund. That is, the investors would invest in the market, they utilizes investors' funds for the investment in terms of building, plants, machinery, or maybe to start a new business. Now, what happens is the entire scenario when the general public invests in the market in form of an equity or a debentures, they become the partner in the business. Now, when the equity shareholders become the partner in the business, they need to share their own profits in terms of the dividend to the investors, that is return on the investments. So company can borrow funds from the, or rather company can invite the investor to invest in the funds, invest in the business for the new project. The moment they invest in the project, they become the partners in the business, that becomes the shareholders in the business. Once the completion of the project is done, or probably when the company starts generating the profit, they can share the profits to the investors in a form of a dividend. The primary market does not basically include the finances from the loan from the financial institutions, is because when the loan is issued from the financial institution, it simply implies that the converting the private capital into the public capital, and in this entire process of converting the private capital into the public capital is called as going public. Now, the common security issued in the primary markets are equity shares, debentures, bonds, preference shares, and innovative securities. Now, second component of the capital market is basically a secondary market. Now, secondary market is basically for the market for the already issued is equity shares or the debentures. Secondary market is a market for the sale and the purchase of previously issued or second-handed securities. Now, in this secondary market, the securities are not directly issued by the company to the investors, but in what happens in this particular market is the securities are sold by the existing investor to the new investor. Sometimes it might happen that an investor is in a need of cash, or another investor wants to buy some equity shares or the shares of the certain company. he may not directly go to the company to buy such particular share. Rather, the both the investors meet in the secondary market, exchange the security for cash, and through this intermediary is called as a broker. Now, in this secondary market, companies get no additional capital as securities are bought and sold between the investors only. So the company does not get benefited out of it in terms of new investments are concerned, but definitely the investor are getting benefited from this particular transaction. So that directly there is no capital formation happening to the company, but the secondary market indirectly contribute to the capital formation by providing the liquidity to the securities of the company. Now if there is no secondary market, then investors could not get back their investments only after the their investments back only after the redemption period is over or when the company gets diluted or the dissolved, which means the investments will block for a very long period of time, but due to the presence of secondary market, the investor can also convert the securities into cash whenever they feel like converting into the cash, or when they want the cash to be liquidated in terms of the secondary market is concerned. And at the same time, it also gives a chance to investors to make profit, basically the difference in the buying and the selling price. As security market are bought and sold market, which generally more than original price of the securities are traded. Now, this liquidity basically offers by the secondary market encourage the investors or even the investors to invest or the general public to invest in the security who want to invest from a small period of time, as there is an option of selling the security at their own convenience. The next very important topic is SEBI, that is known as Security and the Exchange Board of India. Now, Security and the Exchange Board of India, that is known as SEBI, SEBI, was initially constituted on 12th April 1988 as non-statutory body through resolution of government for dealing with all the matters related to development and the regulating the securities, security market, investors protection, and to advise the government on all these matters related to the security market. Now, SEBI was given a statutory status and power through an ordinance of promulgated on January 30, 1992. There are a few functions of SEBI which are very, very important to follow by them. The first function, or the first most important function of SEBI, is basically the registering and regulating the working of stock brokers, sub brokers, share agent, bankers to an issue, trustees or trust deeds. Registrar to an issue, merchant bankers, underwriters, portfolio managers, investment advisory, such other intermediaries who are actually connected to the security exchange and security trading, or maybe associated with the security market in any particular market. The second function is registering and regulating the working of the depositories, depository participant, custodians of securities, foreign institution investors, that is FDI, credit rating agencies who gives credit for the bond and the debenture issue, and such other intermediaries as abroad maybe by notification specifically in that particular behalf. The third function of SEBI is basically registering and regulating the working of the venture capital funds and collecting the investment funds scheme, including mutual funds. Next is helping the business in stock exchange and any other security market. The fifth function is promoting and regulating the self-regulatory organization, that this organization managed by themselves. The next is prohibiting any kind of fraudulent act or unfair trade practices relating to the security market. That is, there should not be anything such as insider trading, or there should not be anything wherein the securities are traded within the organization to attract the more customers or more investors to invest in the market. The next fund is promoting the investors' education, training, and intermediaries of the security market. The very important function of Security Exchange Board of India is prohibiting entire trading in the security. Basically, insider trading is one of the criminal offences which any organization should not perform. At the same time, it should not be conducted in an organization, which is the role of the Security Exchange Board of India to monitor the company should not have insider trading at all. Next is regulating the substantial acquisition of shares and takeover by the company in order to invest one particular project or the functions of the organization. The very important function of SEBI is supervising the working of various organizations trading in the security market and also to ensure the systematic dealing of shares are taken place or not. And the last but not the least is conducting the research and the investigation to ensure the attainment of all the above objectives are fulfilled or not. Now, SEBI plays a very important role when it comes to monitoring all these functions, because when such functions are not performed well, there would be a financial loss to the investors. At the same time, there would be a financial loss to the company as a whole, which indirectly breaks the entire economy of maybe India or any country. So in order to prevent such particular stuff, the company has to, or the regulatory authority has to follow this obligation, and SEBI make sure that all the functions are actually performed well in a matter so that there is no such financial crisis can occur in the particular economy. The next topic is depository system. Now, what do you mean by depository system? Depository system is basically an organization or an institute which assists in allotting and transferring the securities and the security lending. That is, helps the organization in issuing the security for the first time, reissuing the security, or probably in making it available to the end investors. Now, the shares in the depository are held in the form of an electronic account, that is in a form of a dematerialized form, that is generally known as demat account. So that is the dematerialization of the shares possessed by an individual. Initially, when the issues depository systems were not available, the company used to sell the physical form of a shares to the investors, and those investors had to keep a track on the physical shares. At the same time, they have to maintain the physical share. So till the time they are not selling it back to the other investors. But after the introduction of the depository systems, this form was eliminated, and the shares are available in the dematerialized form. And the depository system resolved around the concept of paperless and scriptless trading. Now, there are few features of depository system. The depository first and the foremost features of depository system is the day-to-day functioning, or the day-to-day basis, the reconciliations are made by NSDL. Now, what is NSDL? That is National Security Depository Limited. That is, nationally, this particular system helps in basically maintaining the reconciliation of all the day-to-day activity. The second function is securities are divided and such as can be transacted by in any quantity. It not necessary that the buyer and the seller has to have the same quantity of shares. It can be in terms of anything. If I want to sell, let's say, 100 shares, but then somebody wants to buy only 50 shares, so I can actually sell, and there's the third person who also wants to buy the another 50 shares. I, as an individual, can sell both the entire 100 shares to both of those markets. So they're not necessary that the quantity remains same. The next function is securities are allotted International Security Identification Number, known as ISIN. That is, every security has their own ISIN numbers, and the securities are identified only on the basis of ISIN's number by SEBI. Now, this number is basically given by the SEBI. It has not been offered by the depository system. The benefit of depository system is enjoyed by investors and the owners of the securities. The NSDL and the CDSL. Now, what is CDSL? CDSL is Central Depository Security Limited, and the NSDL is, as I said, National Security Depository Limited, are the two depository participants who act as an agent to intermediate between the brokers and investors. Now, there are few advantages of depository system to multiple parties. The first party who enjoys the advantage of depository systems are the investors. Now, what are the benefits to the investors? The first benefit to the investor is basically it eliminates all the bad deliveries of the security exchange. That is, any mishap can be avoided with the help of dematerialized form. At the same time, any kind of miscommunication or any bad deliveries can be avoided with the help of depository system, because every individual is allotted with particular number, every security is allotted with a particular number. So the chances of any kind of fraud or any kind of bad delivery happening in these entire systems are very, very minimal, which was not the case when the shares were available in the physical format. The next is, it computes the settlement cycle very fast, because initially when the shares were available in the physical form, the company had to go through, or investor had to go through a long process in terms of getting the shares delivered to their own doorstep. So they had to requisite the organization to issue their share, or they had to requisite, and then the transferring agent would agreed on the terms and conditions agreed by the two investors in terms of buying and selling of the shares are concerned. Then the transferer would transfer the physical share from one party to the another party, and then the transfer certificate was generated that stating that the shares have been transferred from one party to the selling party to the buying party, which is a long process which has been avoided, or it has been basically completely eliminated in the after the introduction of the entire depository system, because it actually finished the system very, very fast. If I buy and somebody else is selling, the entire transaction is recorded in a fraction of a second, and then that's the end of the transaction. Now, depository system makes the immediate transfer and the register of the securities without any prior or without any long process of waiting for the investors to get their funds sorted or get the shares delivered in their name, probably because initially the investor had to pay money first and then they had to receive this share certificate, but which is not the case now. They pay and immediately the securities are received by the investor. The next advantage is basically it eliminates all the risk associated with the physical certificate. As I said, there can be many multiple risks along with the in terms of physical share certificates are concerned. Maybe the certificates are lost, maybe certificates are torn, or certificates are damaged, which probably we as investors we cannot trade. So those problems are eliminated completely after the introduction of the depository systems. The next advantage is basically it also provides nomination facilities to the investors, and it reduces the trading cost. Basically, the cost are reduces. And the last but not the least, the advantage of depository system is, since all this thing has become paperless trading, no share certificates or deed etc. required in terms of buying and selling of security. Now, second, the party who enjoys the advantages of depository systems are basically the capital market. Now, we've already understood what does capital market mean, but now let's understand what are the advantages of deposit system which is affecting the capital market. The first advantage is basically all the dues are settled in a very short period of time without any kind of delay or without any kind of waiting in the long queue or waiting for the transaction to get over, get the certificate transfer, and then the dues are settled. All these things taken on an immediate basis. The second advantage is it also eliminates any kind of bad delivery, same as investors. There is no happening or miss or any kind of mishap happen in terms of deliveries are concerned. The third advantage is it also eliminates the problem arising from odd lot of security, that is certain securities are not probably frequently traded and it is not easily available. So those securities are also being traded in the market, and those securities are in the problem arising in terms of trading few not very frequently traded securities are also eliminated. The next advantage is it eliminates the physical handling of paperwork, as I said. And the last, it reduces the error as a whole, because the error are any kind of error or any kind of loss due to physical certifications are concerned are eliminated. Any kind of questions of loss or manipulations or multiations of security does not arise in terms of depository systems are concerned, and the huge number of transactions can be settled in a very short time, because earlier probably in terms of physical share certificates are concerned, not all the huge transactions can be traded fast, but now it becomes much easier because the huge number of buying and selling can happen simultaneously at the same time in a very short period of time. The third party who enjoys basically the advantages of depository systems are the company or the organization as a whole. Now, the first advantage to the organization is it introduces the risk of loss to the securities, and it reduces basically the risk are reduces in terms of losing the securities are concerned. At the same time, it reduces any kind of fraudulent activity. There are very minimal chances any kind of fraud happen. The fraud used to happen when the securities were available in a physical form, but now those things are actually reduced, or rather you can say completely eliminated. The second advantage of depository system, it avoids checking the share deeds and various papers. That is, the paperwork have actually come down to negligible, and everything has become in a dematerialized or non-paper format. The third advantage of basically is no share certificate is issued as securities are divisible, because let's take in consideration that if I have 100 shares of XYZ company, and if somebody wants to buy only 50 shares of that company and we agreed on a one price, but due to the physical form, I really can't divide my 100 shares and sell only 50 to the opposite parties and keep the remaining 50 with me. But now, after the introduction of deposit system, this is also possible, wherein I can actually sell whatever quantity of shares I want, or probably the somebody can buy whatever quantity of shares they want, he or she wants to buy at an agreed price. The shares are actually divisible. It reduces, the next advantage is basically it reduces the various costs which requires the security practice. That is, the cost involved in terms of secretarial practices are reduced, and it supplies the better communication facilities to the end person. The most and the important advantage of depository system to the companies, it is easily availability of data and the information. That is, issue of bonus shares, issue of right share, dividend declaration, etc. is easily available, and it helps the shareholders to take the decision at the same time to judge the entire organization. The last important aspect of capital market is basically the National Stock Exchange of India, which generally we known as NSE. Now, National Stock Exchange of India commenced its operation as a wholesale debt market, basically. That's a debenture in the bond market, you can say, as a long-term loan market in the June 1994 after the introduction of the SEBI. Now, trading in the equity have started in the capital market as we have already discussed in the November 1994. Now, what are the objectives of National Stock Exchange in India was? The first objective is to establish the national-wise trading facilities to all the types of security. It need not necessary that it is restricted only to equity or bond or debentures or on preference shares. It is basically a national-wise facility which is available to all the types of security, be it equity shares known as ordinary shares, be it preference shares, be it debentures or bonds, be it long-term loans, etc. The second objective of NSE is to have the equal access to the information for all the investors in the country through the appropriate communication network. That is, the NSE facilitates the company to have enough knowledge. The knowledge or the information are spread on websites so that anybody can go and check the information regarding their own investments, at the same time regarding the probable investment the investor wants to do. The third objective of NSE is to basically provide an efficient and transparent security market which is fair and equal to all the investors. Now, the next important aspect is to use the electronic trading system and meet international standard and the benchmark, because when the National Stock Exchange was not available, when depository systems were not available, the India used to have the shares which used to trade in the physical form. But after this, it has become more international, it has become more faster, trading system has reduced various eliminated stuff, and it has become more easy to function. Now, another objective of NSE is to have a book entry system as well as it helps all the shortest settlement in the cycle, be it for a single share of any organization, be it for a single debenture of any organization of any price, can be recorded or is actually been recorded, and the entries are made between both the parties directly in an electronic format. Now, NSE operates in three market segments. The first market segment is wholesale debt market segment, which began in June 1994. The second market is capital market segment, which is started in November 1994. And the third market, which was started, is the future and the option, that is FNO, we call it as, or we known as derivative segment, which is started in June 2013. That is basically the investors predict the probable future and the future price, and then they trade in the market. Now, how does NSE organized and managed? The National Stock Exchange in India is managed by the Board of Directors, the Board of Executive Committee, which includes representatives from the trading members, public, and the management, delegates the decision relating to the market operation. Besides this, the exchange operates various committees to advise it on areas such as basically the good market practices, settlement procedures, risk, and the exchange staff are member in this particular committee. The day-to-day management of the exchange is delegated to the managing director, who is supported by the team of professional staff as a whole. Now, if we see NSE, they have different segments. As I said, it has derivatives, it has equity, it has debt, it has multiple segments, and all the segments are traded in the market. But at the same time, all these parties, that is SEBI, NSDL, CDSL, Depository System, and National NSE, all work hand in hand, because all these players play a very important role in making the entire transaction smooth and without any kind of fraud or mishap. Very important aspect in terms of depository systems are concerned, that there are basically the four players to the depository system. The first player is the depository itself, that is the organization. The second is the participant, that is the one who is investing in the firm. The third is the beneficial owner, that is the one who is getting benefited out of the entire transaction. And the fourth is the issuer, that is the one who is issuing the entire security. So that is all about the capital and the security market operations in India. There are a lot more in terms of security transactions are concerned. There are various ways in which the securities are traded, and securities, multiple ways in which the securities are available in the market. Probably we can understand those securities in a forthcoming session. Thank you.